He was a scholar extraordinary, undoubtedly erudite, courageous, inexhaustible in his research. इत्तेफाक से बद बद इत्तेफाक मान लीजिए मुझे कभी मौका नहीं मिला कि अच्छा नूरानी साहब के से रूबरू हो सकता. उनको बहुत जगह देखा, कई जगह पढ़ा, उनकी किताबों को खरीदा पढ़ा, उनको से बहुत कुछ सीखा. लेकिन हमारे यहाँ इतने साथी यहाँ बैठे हैं जिनका ख़ास ताल्लुक नूरानी साहब से रहा, उनसे वाबस्तगी रही, उनसे दोस्ती रही, उनसे एक ख़ास रिश्ता रहा. आई वॉजंट सो लकी एंड आई कंसिडर माई सेल्फ अ बिट इम्पॉवरिश्ड. आई डू बिलीव दैट ही वॉज अ स्कॉलर एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी, अनडाउटेडली एरुडाइट, करेजियस, inexhaustible in his research. And that was before Google and the internet, how he would have searched through documents and piles of dust that would have gotten to the roots of the issues that he wanted to articulate and write about. Intense passion with which he wrote on the subjects that we are all familiar with, and the range of issues of public intellect, unparalleled, I believe, from his time to ours. He was indeed provocative, though interestingly never treated as being controversial. He just touched upon subjects that many of us are scared to even touch, and yet despite his very, very, very provocative views on many of them, which includes the judiciary, this being talked about, the security personnel, yet he was never treated as being controversial, something that sticks to us in public life ever so often now. The remarkable variety of the range of subjects that he dealt with in his books have just been talked about. The widely publicized and circulated books that were mentioned, ranging from constitutional issues generally to 370 Ayodhya. And we do know that on subjects as sensitive as the judgment of the Supreme Court in Ayodhya, as indeed the judgments just may have been mentioned on Hindutva and so on, he took a very strident, very clear, cogent position with which people could disagree. But they were never something that led to any controversy. Of the many books that have been mentioned, and those are books on important, very important historical subjects, on subject of contemporary history, on subjects of the judiciary, subjects that relate to institutions of our country, there is one book that seems to have gone unnoticed. And if you permit me, I will read a little bit from that book to indicate another dimension of the life of this remarkable man and his ability to find the right person and produce the right biography. He did that for a few, a handful, maybe two or three people, but one such biography that is out of print and therefore not easily available now was the biography of the third president, my grandfather, Dr. Zakir Hussain. And I just want to read a couple of paragraphs from the end of that biography that gives a sense of what, for him, an important person was, and how he would have chosen the person for whom he wrote that biography. He wasn't easy to please. He was a friend of friends, and not a friend to those that he found unfriendly, for their views or for something that they had done. And therefore I was very, very pleasantly surprised many years ago when I discovered that he had chosen to write about Dr. Zakir Hussain. This is at page 117, where he talks about the background of Dr. Zakir Hussain becoming president and so on. And then he goes on to say, "It is the president's profound conviction that the Indian milieu will inspire the bold and the original in Muslim thought uninfluenced by political considerations of the state. The occasion when he best expressed his views on the subject was when he addressed the University of Cairo on April 6, 1963. Zakir Hussain referred to the advent of Islam in India and said, I quote, "It introduced a new dimension into Indian life and influenced it tremendously. Religion, politics, language, and literature were all significantly influenced. No wonder, for the proclaimer of the great message of peace and goodwill was one who, for the first time in human history, had the wisdom and the courage to address all mankind." Ya Ezul Hawna is his general form of address. The Catholicity of the message and the great assimilative quality of the Indian genius joined to create a situation of great cultural significance. Even today, after the unfortunate partition of the Indian subcontinent, India has no less than 45 million Muslim citizens and so on and so forth. And then he finally sums up at the end by saying, "These views represent no conscious compromise of two extreme beliefs about Islam in India, the one denying it a place in a distinctive element in national life, the other stressing its distinctiveness to the point of exclusive," but Zakir Hussain out stressing its distinctiveness to the point of exclusiveness. Zakir Hussain's outlook is rather an integrated one fashioned by his profound conception of Islam as a dynamic religion with a reverence for all time as well as by his contacts with the men who were devout Muslims and yet ardent nationalists. It is an outlook that has emerged out of an entire lifetime devoted to the irreproachable Muslim institution conceived and sustained in the spirit of Indian nationalism. 5 years ago, Dr. Zakir Hussain spoke at the convocation of the University of Jammu and Kashmir as follows, I quote, "A true university to fashion our future" was the subject of his address. Its central theme was that the purpose of education is to establish a living and fruitful relationship between the growing mind and the goods of culture. He referred to the Jamewar, the pride of Kashmiri craftsmen. It is the expression of a great culture and reveals many things. It reveals in the first place a passion for excellence. Just imagine it, a passion for excellence, and try to imagine how many, or rather how few of us share it and what disastrous consequences that would lead to. We are just to make the best bargain with life, and a good bargain is one where you give as little as possible to get as much as in return. The bargain Zakir Hussain made with life 47 years ago was of a different quality. To have performed it faithfully is itself no small achievement, but what lends effort to the quality of greatness is the graceful style, the silent address. He was nearly 60 when he last headed an educational institution, a decade of service to the state, and now the presidentship of the Indian Union. The Sheikhul Jamia has become the country's murshid. The assignments have changed. It is certainly not too much to expect that the style will remain the same and the quest for excellence will continue. I do believe this kind of insight for a person, for another person, and projecting it as greatness of the human endeavor is something that is sometimes left unnoticed in the remarkable works that we have seen of Noorani Sahib. And I think it adds a human element to those of us who haven't known him personally, have heard about it, but who haven't experienced it in person. And that human element, I think, is a very significant part of Noorani Sahib, and I salute and acknowledge it. I do believe the message that he's given in this book is a message that remains alive for our times and for the contestations that we face today. Thank you very much.